Everyone, my name is Chris Frantz, and I'm thrilled to be with you tonight in conversation with Julia Cumming for Capital One City Parks Foundation SummerStage Anywhere. SummerStage is New York City's largest free outdoor program performing arts festival and has been a major platform for presenting renowned and emerging artists in New York for over 30 years. That's a good long time.
It is.
Yeah. While health and safety guidelines prevent us from gathering together, SummerStage is bringing digital performances to you anywhere through the month of August and beyond. Look out for more performances at summerstageanywhere.org. All right. Woo! So, I'd like to introduce Julia Cumming, the singer and bass guitarist for Sunflower Bean. Very, very happening new band. I mean, you've been around a few years, but I still think of you as a new band because you're so fresh.
Well, thank you very much. I think so too. We're actually coming up on our 7-year anniversary as a band.
Oh, wow.
Which, you know, I feel like I have that kind of showbiz thing where I'm always, trying to lean on the lower side. Like, if people ask me how long we've been together, I'd say, like, oh, 5 years or... Joy, that's my dog. When I was in my first band, I remember I was 13 when we started. And
wow.
I think I turned 14 and I was about to turn 15 and I didn't let us change the number on the Facebook page because I was like, I only want them to think I'm 14. Let's just stop there. Get inside. I gotta do an interview. Okay. You know, my dog actually is from Kentucky. I've been reading your book.
Oh, good, good. Well, you know, Kentucky is the home of many fine animals. Yeah. And how would you like to proceed? Would you like to talk about my book first, or would you like to talk about, I could ask you a few questions about yourself, and start with now I heard about you, I think it was about 5 years ago, something like that. And I've been trying to get your band to play at what we call our Emerging Artist Series up here in Connecticut.
I've been wanting to, and especially now that there are no shows, the idea of like any show is the best thing
ever. I know. It's terrible for performing artists right now. What can we say? But let me ask you a couple questions. Now, these might seem kind of rudimentary to you, but right. You might have heard them before. But I'd like to, Jacob, Julia, and Nick. That's I like those names, all three of them. Really good.
I think they're good too. Hold on, Joy, baby, stay inside. Go on.
And my question is, I when I was studying up on you, and your band, it seems that many people refer to your style of music as psych rock. Mm-hmm. What exactly? I mean, what does psych rock mean to you?
Well, I think that's a good question, and I think that I can even there's so many things, and this is just like relating to your book even, that I was thinking about in the way that especially you were talking about what you learned in art school and just what you felt in general, that if you were going to make music, you want it to be original. You don't want it to sound exactly like anything else. And I think especially right. making music now, in the past 10 years, you know, there's a feeling of not being necessarily in rock's heyday. So I think when it comes to the words defining your music, as you know for sure, that anyone trying to come up with the exact words for it is never gonna, it's never gonna be correct.
Yeah.
Because there are no words to describe music, you know, there's only the way that it sounds. And I think psych rock made a lot of sense for us early on. You know, I think that was kind of a lot that we were inspired by, kind of spacier, more out there tones, and the ability to take a song and play it for 7 or 8 minutes and kind of that psychedelic feeling. But I wouldn't necessarily call us like a psych rock band now in the way that I really think of what psych rock is. That seems, psych rock to me feels a lot more California, and I think we've always really, really been defined by being a New York City band.
I get it. But so psych refers to psychedelic.
Yeah.
Not like psychotic or
unfortunately not psychotic. That would be a lot cooler, I think.
Do you like psychedelics? I mean, does your band ever take them?
My band is luckily not a very druggy band. Uh-huh. Even though I know psychedelics are different, but I think, you know, we have been a band that has been touring really, really consistently for pretty much our entire careers. And in order to do that, I feel like on tour, we have to stay very straight, you know?
Yeah.
No drinking. I mean, not totally no drinking, but I try not to drink or anything on tour so I don't get sick. And then I come back home and I have one drink and I'm like, oh,
yeah.
Wasn't prepared. Sorry, I keep. I have my phone delicately balanced on a 10-pound weight, so it keeps kind of.
Very good. Okay. Well. Okay. So psych rock is a type of psychedelic music, and it's you try to keep it fresh. You don't like to get overly psychedelic, I gather. Tell me again when your band got started and how did you learn to play bass guitar?
Well, this band started in 2013. I was about to turn 18 years old. And I had played guitar in my previous band that I started, when I was 13, which I know you were also playing music when you were 13. There's so many things in the book where I'm like, these are, you know, it's kind of like seeing the path of how someone really does this with their life. Because as you know, there's no college degree for like rock musician, you know, but when you read everyone's stories, you can kind of see how the similarities go. But, yeah, I played some guitar and I played some bass, but mostly to try to teach the bass parts of the songs to like a rotating cast of characters that were in the band. And I met Nick and Jacob, who are from Long Island, and they were like, it's kind of similar to the book. They were like, you should join the band. They had a rotating cast of bass players and they were like, we really want you to play bass in this band. And I was like, no, I don't want to do it, because
I think there's a lot of shyness, and I felt a certain shyness playing with new people and feeling like they were going to judge me for not being good enough or not, you know, being super technical. And they were never like that, you know. It was kind of like, it was the first time that I went from almost like a more, my first band was very art focused, where we didn't practice as much and we were more kind of like conceptual. And then this was the band where I really had to practice. and then once I started practicing, I was like, oh shit, this is how you do it, you know?
You had a revelation.
Yeah. And also to everyone watching, apologies about the low light. My phone is a little broken due to living life. And the band is actually inside cooking dinner right now. So this is the quietest place for me to be. So those are my technology apologies.
Well, it's okay. Soft lighting is very attractive.
Thank you. It's very, very dreamlike. Just imagine that I'm, you know, coming out of a fog.
Yeah, it just got better there for a moment when you held your hands up.
I'm trying to see how I can get the
that's better. Is that really hard?
Well, it's kind of an extreme angle. We'll see. We'll make it work.
Okay. So let's, your singing is really good too. I got to tell you, I particularly love I Was a Fool and 22. And the harder rocking ones, the early ones were a little bit more raw, I think. And I like those too. Easier said, and all really, you know, really well sung. So
thank you.
Congratulations on getting that together.
Thanks.
I was watching your videos because it's fun to watch a video on YouTube. And do you ever think about the video as you're writing the song, or before you write the song, or is the video a secondary, just marketing tool, or you know, something to promote the song?
I think artists that think with the video in mind are probably really smart, because you know, music and visuals go together, you know, so hand in hand, visual art and music videos being kind of like that visual representation is really important. But then there's the other kind of side of it where it's like, sometimes making a music video is like a total drag and a pain in the ass. And you're like, why can't I just play my songs and hope that people will get it? But that's not how life works either. So, you know, I don't usually think with the video in mind, but I do get excited now when we start doing it, because I feel like it's a great way to tell another side of the story of the song, and a great way to develop further as an artist. Considering yourself a musician can be stifling too. You know what? I'm sure maybe you felt that as well, because sometimes just like musician on musician stuff can be so like conceptually narrow, you know, and you're like, all we ever do is talk about guitar tones, and I want to talk about, you know?
Yeah.
And I think it's important for artists to push themselves and try to feel confident in those visual realms as well. Cause it's super important. But did you feel that way in your musical career with music videos? Like, was it stressful or was it exciting?
The only time it was stressful is twice when we were shooting videos, I caught the flu. I like arrived at the video shoot. One of them I had even done the storyboards for and organized. It was the song called Stay Up Late.
Ooh.
we were flying in the on these wires and stuff up and down like a jolly jumper for a baby.
Uh-huh.
And I got the flu. And another time in London, we were shooting a Tom Tom Club video for Suboceana. I got the flu for that one too.
Oh my God.
That was terrible. But when we had fun doing it was, when we could get into costumes and things and like dress up and just do silly kind of things like on Road to Nowhere and Wild, Wild Life and, even burning down the house.
We
had fun. We went to this abandoned nightclub called The World on the Lower East Side at the bottom of, I think it's at the bottom of First Avenue,
mm-hmm.
and at Houston Street. And
we
actually played there once or twice with Tom Tom Club, but it was kind of abandoned and we used it as a set for the performance in Burning Down House. And we wore tails. That was kind of fun to wear tails.
That is fun.
Yeah.
You gotta let yourself have fun. I mean, kind of speaking of that area, and, you know, to kind of bring in like how we sort of have been knowing around each other for the past few years is that you have a radio show at WPKN where my dad has a radio show.
That's right.
And my dad happens to be one of the, you know, largest Talking Heads and Tom Tom Club fans that I know in my life. And when I was a kid, we used to drive around and listen to, you know, like don't worry about the government, and kind of like as he kind of showed me that song, I think, as a lesson to what a song could be. You know, it was kind of like a song doesn't have to be about love. It doesn't have to be about anything. It can be about whatever you want as long as you know what you're doing and it's you, you know? And I really kind of, I took that to heart. And he also took me to CBGB's before it closed. I think I was like 7 years old and he brought me in there at like 2 p.m. And all I remember is that it stunk. It smelled so bad. It smelled like old bread and dirt.
Yeah.
And it was damp. And my dad brought me in there. And he was like, Jules, I can't explain why, but one day it's going to be really important that you were here. And you were inside this room. And I was like, whatever, I'm 7. This is disgusting. And now, you know, I'm so glad, you know, it was completely right. And I owe a lot of my relationship to music, to my relationship with my father, which is really cool. And I think just very, very special. And I'm really glad that he was able to even meet you and we were able to kind of get in contact.
Yeah. Your dad's a great guy. Did he teach you to play bass or sort of help?
He did. He taught me how to play guitar more so, and he definitely taught me bass tricks. You know, I took some guitar lessons, but mostly he was the one who would show me things. A lot of times, like before school, like I would be like, Dad, you know, he would wake up at like 6 a.m. to play music with me before I went to school.
Wow.
And,
that's dedication.
It is dedication. It really is. And then we would listen to music just in the car all the time, just everywhere. We would sing harmonies together. And yeah, it's just, you know, it's been very special to have a musical connection with him.
Uh-huh. And what aspect of being in a band do you love most? Writing, recording, or being on the road? Or all of the above? Or none of the above?
You know, I think I would have to say all of the above.
Uh-huh.
My you know, there's a moment in your book, Remain in Love, which I am reading,
uh-huh.
in which you kind of talk about that moment that you had at 17 where you're like, I'm going to be an artist. I'm going to do this. You know, and I think there comes a point in everyone who does this, you know, in their lives when that happens. And my first memory when I was like 4 years old is of wanting to be in a band. I wanted to be in the Beatles too. That's what I thought. I said, I'm going to do the Beatles too. And I didn't know why the Beatles always had to be singing songs about girls. And I asked my mom, I was like, do you think I could sing a song about a boy? You know, these are just the old, you know, I didn't understand why it was always kind of coming from there. And until I was 13, like until I was in a band, I just felt like my life was waiting to start, you know? And now that I've been able to do it, I just feel, I love everything about it. I think if you asked me like 2 years ago when we were playing, or like even last year when we played, you know, hundreds of shows a year, I would say, I just want to get home and write some songs.
Uh-huh.
And I don't want to play anymore. And now that feels really far away, there's no way that I could say that I don't love performing, because music is communication, you know, and it's that urge to communicate something.
Yeah.
And without performing, you know, you're missing that element.
Do you get stage fright ever? I mean, like bad stage fright?
I would say stage anxiety. I was nervous for our conversation tonight. It wasn't frightful, but it was like nerves. Like 10 minutes before, I was like, oh my God, I'm going to talk to Chris fucking Frantz. It's going to be so awesome. And I got kind of like that feeling. I haven't, you know, been like, uh-huh, really performing anything, but do you feel like you have stage fright or?
I not very often, but a couple of times I have gotten it. And it's no fun at all. The first time I had a very bad case of it was when Tom Tom Club did our debut concert in New York at CBGB's. It was in 1988, and we did a residency at CBGB's. I walked in and I said, you know, Hilly, we got this new album coming out, and I'd like to do like a residency at CBGB's, 3 weeks. And Hilly said, great idea, because, you know, business was not the best in the late 80s. So we booked 15 nights over five nights a week for 3 weeks in the same venue. And so that was really fun. But the first night I arrived at the venue, and there were, you know, I was used to playing with Talking Heads and all this support. And it was just me and Tina and two other guys on guitar and keyboards, sort of a stripped down Tom Tom Club, I guess. Mm-hmm. And I pulled up, well, I think I took a cab down from the Gramercy Park Hotel. This was before the Gramercy was remodeled. It was still like a rock and roll hotel. And I saw that there was a line around the block, and my stomach just felt like it was going to, you know, jump up my throat or something. And I've never had any experience like that before. But once I got out onto the stage and like hit the drums a couple of times, everything was cool. Thank goodness.
Yeah. The second you kind of get out there, like you walk on those steps, I feel like it usually kind of goes away.
Yeah.
But it definitely exists. It's part of the, you know, rush. But that's really bold to book that many nights in a row.
Yeah, it was really fun. And at the end, we had a different opening act, or sometimes two opening acts every night. So that was changing. And we had special guests. We had Debbie Harry came up and sang. We had done a cover version of Femme Fatale. Mm-hmm. And she sang that with us. And Dee Dee Ramone played guitar with us one night, and especially on the song Psycho Killer. He said, Dee Dee said, Chris, man, these songs are really hard. Finally, on the final night of that run, we had Lou Reed join us on stage, and we did Sweet Jane, Rock and Roll, Femme Fatale, and Psycho Killer with Lou. And I can tell you, the kids went nuts for Lou Reed when he came out on stage. And he was very nice about coming down, and he knew we had covered Femme Fatale, which of course he wrote, and he played guitar on it actually in the recording and sang background vocals. And so he's very nice about it. When I called him up, I said, "Lou, you want to come down and play at CBGB's?" And he said, "If you send a limo." So I said, "Okay, I'll send a limo." And so we sent the biggest stretch limo we could find for Reed and brought him to the front of CBGB's. And I don't know if you've ever seen anybody, you were a little young at the time, but to see somebody step out of a big stretch limousine in front of CBGB's was a sight to behold. And of course, everybody was like, "Oh my God, it's Lou Reed." And the seas started, place was packed. The seas parted to let Lou come through. And it was a great night, really wonderful.
That's awesome. I know that I haven't got to the chapter yet, but I know that there's a really interesting kind of story about the time that Lou Reed wanted to produce the Talking Heads.
Yes.
And
yes.
Came over to his,
yes.
his house.
To his credit, he was really he was one of the first real, you know, rock stars.
Yeah.
If not the first to come to CBGB's on a fairly regular basis. He would really come down and check out the bands, and he loved television, and I'm pretty sure he loved Patti Smith and her group, but he found out when he saw us play, he found out, "Ooh, I love Talking Heads." And yeah, he invited us up to his apartment, and it was really super exciting. We'd only been playing for like several months at the time. So Lou Reed was actually one of the reasons we moved to New York, and Andy Warhol, and you know, these were our heroes, you know, and they lived in New York, so we thought we should go there too.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people still feel that way. I still see bands with sort of pseudo Lou Reeds at the front, and I think about the enduring impact of his life and his art on the New York City sound, and you guys as well. I mean, I think, you know, people often, and this kind of goes back into what we were talking about before, ask me about the difference between like West Coast rock and East Coast rock. And it was funny that you said psych rock, like psychotic rock, because I think that's a perfect example for what New York rock sound historically and still kind of is. You know, I feel like there's an inherent sort of neuroses in the music that comes out of New York City based on just the intensity of living in that space, you know?
Yeah.
There's just this, you know, how are you going to make something laid back and chill when you're surrounded by rats and concrete and garbage and roaches? I mean, I never say, it's not about if you have roaches or rats. It's about what you do with the ones that are already there because you're sharing that space.
Yeah.
You know? So I think that's something I've always felt, is this kind of being proud of that tense feeling, that kind of tense, neurotic, intellectual feeling that comes from making art in New York City.
What are your we can't really go out now and you know, visit nightclubs and stuff, but what are your favorite haunts in New York?
Well,
past and present.
Yes. My favorite venue to play, I think, is Bowery Ballroom. Uh-huh. I think that, you know, it's kind of perfect for that the combination that you really want from like a rock show. You want a place that's one of a kind and kind of glamorous and also kind of sort of rough around the edges. You know, you want that unique feeling where you can create something really special in that performance, that you feel like the venue can hold that. And I think Bowery is my favorite. But I, you know, there's a club called Berlin that I DJ a lot in the past year at, and it's kind of, it has, you know, a sort of secret feeling where, you know, you sort of have to know what's going on, and DJing there can be interesting because you're kind of down in this dank little basement and wondering if anyone's gonna kind of find it. But I'm very grateful to have done that, and kind of, you know, gives me a reason to stay up late and do fun stuff. But when I started playing and started doing stuff around the East Village when I was in the 13, 14 range, I used to go to the Sidewalk Cafe open mic uh-huh. on Monday nights. Uh-huh. And then I went to the Tuesday night open mic at Bowery Poetry Club, which was one of my favorite venues to play. And that was kind of my two main haunts. And now, of course, neither of them exist. I never thought that I hoped I wouldn't see the day when Sidewalk became a sushi restaurant, but it has happened. But I remember one time playing a show at the Bowery Poetry Club, and I had actually invited my my eighth grade like humanities teacher to come to the show and see it. And it was like kind of a it was like a bunch of like multimedia artists kind of doing stuff, and I think there was a video performance of someone like taking a strawberry in and out of their vagina, like right after we were playing. And I was like, oh my God, my teacher's gonna come to this fucking show and see all this crazy shit. And luckily she didn't, on Monday I saw her, she didn't show up. And she was like, I'm so sorry I didn't make it. And I was like, thank God you didn't go to the Bowery Poetry Club, because there was some really crazy shit going on.
that's marvelous.
That's what those venues were for, you know, and that's...
Was that right across the road from CBGB's? Right across the Bowery? Yeah. I never went in there, but I would walk by and say, oh, that looks inviting. Kind of like an Irish bar or something.
Yeah, it was really cool. And what they would do is, like, they knew that, like, me and that I had school the next day, like the people that ran the open mics. And so, you know, sometimes you would have to pick a number out of your hand, pick any number that, and no matter what number it could have been, they always gave me like number 3 or number 4. So they knew that I could get home early and go to school the next day.
Wow. So the other day, Julia, we were talking, you use this term that I really enjoyed, the cool new wave.
Yes.
So, I like that. That's a good. That's a good, how shall I say it? Descriptor. Mm-hmm. But what bands to you, other than your own? What bands or artists represent the cool new wave to you right now?
Well, I think one thing that's really cool about the time that we're living in right now is technology, right? I mean, it's making this conversation possible. And it makes kind of the collaboration between bands and artists really possible in a whole different way, because a lot of times those relationships can exist online. So like I worked this year with an artist called Yves Tumor, who's on Warp Records, and actually the lyric video just came out for that today. And that's someone who I consider who's doing really, really amazing stuff. Ooh, I have a little lighting rig going on. Who's doing really amazing stuff, kind of at the intersection of visual arts and music. You know, I think that's someone who's really pushing the boundaries for sure.
Did you say his name was Deep Tumor?
His name is Yves Tumor, Y-V-E-S.
Oh, Yves.
Yeah.
Oh, like Saint Laurent Yves.
Yes. Yeah. I'll send it to you.
Okay.
And see what you think, because I would be really curious about it. But I think what I've struggled with in New York City, and I think this is probably, you know, it's sort of to be expected, is the real tenseness that's existed in the past 10, 15 years, the financial tenseness and creative tenseness that has like gone past the point of being kind of inspiring and has become really stifling, you know? And I think for a lot of New York artists currently, there's been this feeling of like, is it ever going to change? Like, what would it take for there to be real artistic freedom again in New York City that may have existed in the heyday that everyone dreams about? That everyone, you know, everyone who's chasing the Lou Reed dream, who wants to have that kind of experience, is it possible? Because, you know, you're not allowed to play house shows anymore. There's no like spaces that ever seem to allow you to be experimental in the way that you want to. And this is what we were talking about the other day when I said the new wave of cool, you know, because there's all these articles about everyone leaving New York City at, you know, a massive rate. There's this, you know, this feeling of almost like this like skepticism about everything New York has been through and if it can kind of come back from that. And to that, you know, there's a lot of excitement, you know, because now there's kind of this idea of like, you know, if a bunch of things close, if a bunch of things are kind of out, we can kind of swoop in with these new artistic ideas and have a little bit of freedom to make something loud and make something weird and not be shut out by the kind of Duane Reeds of the world and the, you know, I don't know, the Whole Foods of the world, you know, just kind of like, and that's what I'm most excited about now. You know, the people that are staying in New York City and staying in New York State, you know, I have so much pride for New York City and New York State. And as much as it, you know, would make sense to go to LA and try to fit in with all those people and kiss ass and hang around and, you know, it's like, it would never make sense. I want to be here in New York City.
It warms my heart because, like, for example, when Devo moved from Akron, Ohio to Hollywood, mm-hmm. I thought to myself, uh-oh,
mm-hmm.
the end is near.
Yeah.
Of course they have continued, but
you know,
and they've done some great stuff. I'm sure people in LA are watching, but in New York we have SummerStage. Did you ever play SummerStage?
I'm not sure. I might have in some way, because I know that SummerStage does a lot of different kind of stuff, and I kind of forget. If my manager was here, I'm sure she'd be like, Julia, you have played this, or like, I just can't remember. But I have gone to many, many summer stage events. I've
yes, me too.
And it's, you know, that's what's cool about it. And I love, you know, California, and I love to visit, and I love to make music out there. But it's all, you know, you eat some hamburgers, you get a tan, you, you know, you buy some cowboy boots, and then you go home to New York and you laugh about it all. And, you know, you,
right.
you see your friends. And
that's, you know, that's a very good description of a tour of America.
And my dad just texted me and said, you did last summer. So last summer, I think, yeah, last summer we played a show at this kind of, it was a bandshell show.
Yeah.
Yes. And that was with porches, and it got rained out, but that was, I think that was the show that SummerStage did. I'm just, to SummerStage, it's me being, you know, spazzy and forgetful, but I'm very grateful for, you know, every New York show is the best show.
Somebody here says you played 2018.
I believe it. Look, I believe it. If you saw me there, I played it.
I think last time I played was quite some time ago with the B-52s, Tom Tom Club and the B-52s.
I saw that photo. I saw the photo that SummerStage posted.
Yeah, that was a gas. And, mm-hmm. But tell you what, ask me a question about my book.
Okay, your book. I'm loving it.
I'm reading it. Have you seen the cover?
Yeah, I've seen the cover. The cover is iconic.
Yeah, the cover is pretty good. A woman named Megan Wilson designed that cover.
And I love it. I saw today that is it number one in like punk rock biographies?
It has been number one in punk rock biographies for some time. But today I got knocked out of the number one slot. I'm number two.
By who?
I'm still number one for Kindle.
Okay.
But for the hard copy, some book about Bad Religion, that the band Bad Religion. I guess they have a lot of fans who buy on Amazon. But I'm top 10 in London on the bestseller list in the UK. And the New York Times is giving me no love at all. I can say, what kind of world do we live in where I get more love from the Wall Street Journal than I get from the New York Times? I mean, please.
But, you know, the Wall Street Journal actually, I think, did a really nice piece on us when the last record came out, I was also surprised. I was like, this is so cool. I think that the Wall Street Journal rock journalism is actually really good. So that's something to feel good about. So I wrote a lot of different kind of notes about the book. One thing that I kind of wanted to discuss is that we've been listening to the Happy Mondays a lot and just actually watched 24 Hour Party People. And I didn't know that you and Tina produced that record.
We produced it's called Yes Please is the name of the album, and we did it in the I write about this in the book at some length. We did it in the poor Tina and I, we were so innocent. We thought, oh, the Happy Mondays, I hear they have some hits, we should work with them. So because they invited us to produce their record, and this was at the time when Nirvana was just breaking. And there was a lot of emphasis on, you know, being real. And the Happy Mondays hits prior to this had been basically remixes by Paul Oakenfold, a great DJ and a great remixer. And, you know, he did an excellent job for them. And they sold out arenas, and they sold lots of records in the UK and Europe. But on this one, they wanted to play their own instruments. What an idea. I said, yeah, I think you should play your own instruments. And Tina agreed. And mm-hmm. we went down to Barbados and we made a record with them down there at a studio called Blue Wave, which is in the middle of a giant sugarcane field. It's owned by Eddie Grant, the guy who sang Electric Avenue and and many, many other hits. So we were down there, and yes, I got my first gray hairs there, working with the Happy Mondays. Nobody told us about the lead singer's drug addictions or the band's like insane behavior. Let's just say it was almost a disaster, and I think most producers would have just quit, would have said, I'm out of here. But we, Tina and I are the type of people that if we say we're going to do something, we do it. Mm-hmm. So we finished the job. We ended up finishing it over in England after Sean detoxed.
Right. Because as you left Barbados, it was just a instrumental record.
Yes. It was an instrumental album and, no vocals. He couldn't sing. We got him into the studio one day to sing, and let's just say that it didn't work out. Mm-hmm. He's doing great now. I mean, and the band has reunited, and they mm-hmm. They do these mega festivals and things together in Europe. But yeah, that one episode we had in our career.
And kind of speaking about, you know, vocals and lyrics, there's different lyrics of yours that I read in the book, and I know that, you know, there were often kind of, not often, but there, you know, was times that maybe it seemed like David sort of forgot that there were some things that you kind of wrote, and I know that was not great, but more so I was thinking, has writing lyrics been something that came easy to you in your history as an artist, or did it feel difficult? Because I am personally currently struggling with a lot of lyrics, and as I was reading stuff that you were writing, I was like, I wonder kind of where you pulled from and what your experience was like with just lyric writing.
Well, I was a kid who loved to write poetry. I would actually, when I was a teenager in Pittsburgh, I would actually go to these nights. It was called the International Poetry Forum. And we saw the great poets of the world, Robert Lowell and Yuri Yevtushenko. And, you know, and others.
Yeah.
And others. And they would read their poetry in front of a live audience, and it was very inspiring to me. And I wrote, you know, I would write poetry. You know who else really inspired me to write poetry or lyrics was Bob Dylan, because I guess I was about 14 or 15 when I first heard Like a Rolling Stone. And I went to see him live in person down in Virginia, where I was going to school, and it's a big inspiration. But so I love to write, and when it came to writing lyrics for songs, I didn't find it particularly difficult or anything. But the challenge is to make it interesting enough and like deep enough or fun enough so that people want to hear those lyrics over and over again. They want to, they're able to listen to it again and again without getting sick of it.
Yeah.
And that's the challenge with lyric writing.
It is. And it's a really fine line, because I mean, I've definitely gone to like poetry readings in the city, and there's that kind of really kind of pure poet feeling that you get from kind of going to those events. And then when you think about being a musician in lyrics, you're like, well, I don't really fit. I'm not, as a writer, I'm not fitting in there.
and I don't want to do something like totally stupid, but you have to find, you know, it's like you have to find how to use that kind of poetry in a way that communicates the melody. It's just a really particular skill that gets me caught up the most. So I was wondering kind of how you felt about it. But
I was a kid who grew up loving writing, and I still do today. I hadn't done any for quite some time when I sat down to write this book. Mm-hmm. And it was, I gotta say, it was like, well, I wanted to do it. I really wanted to do it. But when I first sat down and I, you know, one or two chapters is okay. But when you think about, you know, 400 pages or something, it gets to be like, oh my God, what did I get myself into? But
I think a lot of people think about, you know, if they end up having a cool life, they're like, you know, maybe I wonder what it'd be like to write a book about it. But how long were you kind of thinking about this book and what brought you to make it now?
I was thinking about it for a good 10 years, if not more. And but I was, I don't want to say lazy, but I was waiting to see, you know, timing is my business, Julia.
Right.
I was waiting for what I thought would be a good time. And at a certain point, about two and a half years ago, I thought, now is the time. I got to do it now. The world still loves Talking Heads. The world's still interested in Talking Heads. And I've still got my marbles. I can remember things, you know. I better get it down before I lose my marbles. So I did it. And, you know, it's my first book, so I'm very happy that many people seem to be enjoying it. Mm-hmm. And thank you for this discussion. Can you see what time it is?
Let me see. It's 8:54. We have 5 minutes left, I guess.
Okay.
But I do have one kind of another question I would love to ask someone.
Okay.
in your position, who is a literal rock icon. You don't have to be humble about it. Just, you know, and I get waiting, you know, because also when you make art, you never know. There could be something amazing around the corner all the time that you might want to write about and put in the book. But
yes.
The book is called Remain in Love, and I have felt, you know, I'm coming up on a few years with Sunflower Bean, who are all people that I love, and I wanted to ask you about how you kind of felt that you keep that love alive in your relationship or artistic relationships, and also how to remain in love with your artistic ideas, you know, because you might have this idea when you start a band or you start a project, and then a few years down the line you change and you know, and you're kind of wondering what you were thinking about before. And so I just kind of wanted to ask how you as an artist have continued to persevere with your original thoughts and remain in love with your artistic life and relationships.
Okay. Well, you know, in my relationship with Tina, my personal relationship, I think the things that are most important in number one, keep the romance alive.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever it takes. If it takes roses, if it takes, you know, cooking a delicious beef bourguignon or something like that, chocolates, a trip to the Martha's Vineyard or whatever it takes, do it and keep that relationship alive. But really what it boils down to is kindness, patience, and I think a good sense of humor is very necessary, because you know, sometimes in this life, this artistic life, we tire ourselves out, we get overly tired and we get cranky, and that's not good. That's not good. So Tina and I try to amuse each other with jokes, little jokes. And sometimes they're not funny and sometimes they're hilarious. But we try to, you know, make each other smile and make each other chuckle. Once in a while, if you get a real guffaw, that's success.
True.
Yeah. Does that answer?
Artistically,
I just take it nowadays, you know, you could almost call me an elder statesman now. I mean, I feel young, but I have to realize that I'm a man of a certain age. So I just take it one day at a time with the arts. Nobody's, unlike yourself, nobody's breaking down the door for a new, you know, record from me. If I want to do a recording, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
But if I want to go for a swim in the pool instead, I'll do that. I just take it like one day at a time. And I've been working very hard, I must say, promoting this book. This is like my ninth interview today.
Oh my gosh.
But it's the best. It's definitely the best and most fun.
Well, I see
we have 1 minute and 22 seconds remaining.
Yes.
So tell me, anything you'd like to say to your fans or to the audience out there that.
Well, anything I'd like to say. I would like to say to everyone who's watching and to SummerStage, thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of this amazing conversation with a personal hero, with Chris Frantz, who I've been dying to meet for a very long time and work with. And I hope that this can be the beginning of hopefully more friendship and even, you know, recordings. It would be awesome to.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Make some music together. And I, you know, and to Sunflower Bean fans, we're definitely working. I have to be a little quiet about what it is, but we're definitely here. And again, someone said save our stages, but yes, live music has saved us all. And I'm very lucky to do what I do and very
excellent.
Lucky to talk with Chris.
Well, we've got 5 seconds, so I'm just going to say, okay, bye. Thank you, Julia.